We tried to think about the most primitive information we have. Regarding our extraordinary experience is that I think we choose the fact that all humanity has always been born naked, absolutely helpless for months, and though with beautiful equipment, as we learned later on, no experience, therefore absolute ignorant. That's where all humanity has always started. And we've come to the point where in our trial and error, finding our way, stimulated by a designed in hunger, designed in thirst, these are conscious inputs, designed in procreative urge. We have plus an enormous amount of, as we learn later on, designed in automated processing of the interrelationships of our all the atoms in our organism. Starting then with a consciousness of the hunger, giving a drive to go after, and to seek, to experiment. Man having then no rule book, nothing to tell him about that universe, has had to really find his way entirely by trial and error. He had no words, had no experience to assume the other person had an experience. He had at first a very incredibly limited way of communicating. We now know human beings being on our planet for probably 3.5 million years, with, as far as we can see, not much physiological change, pretty much the same skeleton. And what we can learn of human beings in their earliest recorded communicating in an important degree, people in India 5,000 years ago, China 5,000 years ago, were thinking very extraordinarily well in terms of anything we know about our experience, the way we've been able to resolve experiences into the discovery of principles that seem to be operative in our universe. I'm astonished at how well the early Hindu Chinese thinker, how well he was able to process his information in view of the very much, very limited amount of information humanity had as of that time in comparison to anything we have today. Just making a little jump on information, as humanity on board of our planet entered into what it called World War I, these scientists around the world have ways of reporting to one another officially, and chemists have what they call chemical abstracts. The chemical abstracts are methodical publication of anything and everything any chemist finds that he publishes information regarding it, which comes to chemical abstracts. As of entering World War I in the 20th, what's recorded in the 20th century, is a very arbitrary kind of a counting matter, we had some about 175,000 known substances, possibly almost a quarter of a million substances by the time the United States came into the war, known to chemistry. But we came out of World War I with almost a million substances known. By the time we entered World War II, we were well up into 10 million. And we've come out of it now where the figure is really getting me astronomical. We can't really keep track of the rate at which we're discovering more. Just talking about differentiable substances, chemically distinct from one another. Those are typical of the information. Really, it's a bursting rate now in relation to I'm speaking in relation to my own life. One life and the extraordinary numbers of lives there must have been on board of our planet. That the information is in multiplying that rate during just one lifetime indicates that something is going on here right now that is utterly unprecedented, and we're in such indication of acceleration of experience as human beings, the integration of the accelerated, the experienced, to produce awarenesses that are indicative of humanity going through some very, very important kind of transition into some kind of new relationship to universe, I'd say. The kind of acceleration that would occur after the child has been formed in the womb, taking the 9 months, and then suddenly begins to issue from the womb out into an entirely new world. I think we're apparently coming through out of some common womb of designedly permitted ignorance, given faculties which we gradually discover and learn to employ by trial and error. And we're at a point where I now have what would also seem absolutely incredible to generations before. I've now completed 37 circuits of our Earth, kind of zigzagging circuits, not straight around, not tourists, just responding to requests to appear here and there, to lecture at universities or to design some structure, whatever it may be. So that is in the everyday pattern that I'm circuiting that Earth. Certainly makes it in evidence that we are dealing in a totality of humanity, not the up to my generation, completely divided humanity, spread very far apart on our planet. My father was in the nether importing business in Boston, Massachusetts, United States, and he imported from two places primarily, the Buenos Aires and in India, for bringing in leathers for the shoe industry of which was centered at that time in the Boston area. And his mail, or a trip that he would like to make to Argentina, took 2 months each way. And his trip to India in the mail took exactly 3 months each way. And it seemed absolutely logical to humanity when early in this century, Rudyard Kipling, the English poet, said, "East is east and west is west, and never the twain shall meet." They're very, very rare matter for any human being to make such a travel as that, taking all those months. There were not many ships that could take him there. All that has just changed in my lifetime to where I'm not just one of a very few making these circuits of the Earth, but I'm one of probably getting to be pretty close to 20 million now who are living a life like that around our planet. And very much the whole young world doing so. I keep meeting my students at various universities from around the world, halfway around the world again. They're all getting to be living as world people. So this is a very sudden emergence into some new kind of relationship to our universe that's being manifest. None of it was planned. There was nobody in the time of my father, my mother, as I was brought up, prophesying any of the things I just said. The year I was born, Marconi invented the wireless, but it did not get into any practical use until I was 12 years of age, when the first steamship sends an SOS that's in distress by wireless. So think of it. Great many miles, and the world began to know the ship was in distress, and ships began to rush to its aid. Absolutely unexpected. My father and mother would say, "Wireless?" Such nonsense. And when I was 3, the electrons discovered, and nobody talked about that. There wasn't any the newspapers, or nobody's interested in electrons. Didn't know where this electron was been discovered. I was brought up that the humanity would never get to the North Pole, absolutely impossible, and never get to the South Pole. And our Mercator maps didn't even show anything up the northernmost points were very rugged, kind of a line, but you didn't see it, know anything up beyond that. When I was 14, man did get to the North Pole, and I was 16, he got to the South Pole, so the impossibles were happening. Like all other little boys, I was making paper darts, which you could make at school. Boys must have been making them a very long time. And we were hoping we might be able to get to flying. But the parents said, Darling, it's very, very amusing for you to try that, but it's inherently impossible for a man to fly. So when I was 7, the Wright brothers suddenly flew. And my memory is vivid enough of 7 to remember that for about a year, the engineering societies were trying to prove it was a hoax. It was absolutely impossible for a man to do that. So then, not only was that that radio, but when I was 23, which is what you think, I guess many in this room are not 23 yet. When I was 23, the human voice came over the radio for the first time. And that's an incredible matter. When I was 27, we had the first licensed radio broadcasting. When I was 38, I was asked to go on an experimental TV studio program in New York where the Columbia Broadcasting had 70 sets, which were in various scientists and their board of directors' homes, and they had experimental programs going out, and so they didn't have any money for paying anybody. The man who ran it, Gilbert Seldes, was a friend of mine, ran the studio, and so I often appeared on his program, but we don't have television operating in the United States until after World War II. So we were talking about, I was 40, 45 when we had our first television. So this couldn't be more recent matter. And nobody thought at that time they didn't know you were going to have transistors. They didn't know you were going to have, man was going to have satellites going around the Earth. They didn't know we were going to have radio relay satellites, that we're going to be able to have programs coming out of any power of the Earth, any other power of the Earth. Absolutely. Not one of these steps was ever anticipated by any of the others. So that having experienced that, I also experienced living with my fellow human beings who I find no sooner has it happened than he said, I knew it all the time. I'm not one of those to be surprised. I was sort of in on it, you know. I was a little bit responsible. There is a strange vanity of man, and I think the vanity that he has was essential to his being born naked and helpless and having to make the fantastic number of mistakes he had to make in order to really learn something. And I think he'd been so disgruntled, so dismayed by the mistakes and the errors that he would never have been able to carry on. He would just been absolutely discouraged. So he was given a strange vanity to say, continually sort of make himself exempt, and that he was some kind of privileged and always in. And he's able to then quite clearly deceive himself a great deal. So I find everybody today, so getting the moon, anybody do that, that's absolutely simple and logical. Now, it is obvious and simple and logical, provided you were born, and this has happened in your lifetime, you can see how it happened. I began to realize with that rapid changing going on, which was not anticipated, that what people call natural when I was young, the natural related to a state before these great changes occurred, where we were supposed to say we were inherently remote from other human beings. No way you can get the other human beings. And all the custom had been developed over millions and millions of years of tribes and little communities being isolated one from the other. How you got on with one another, seeing everybody, you saw everybody a great deal all the time. The conditions that were really brought about by that constant proximity brought about human behaviors, which we have now rules. And everybody said that, the older people say that's where you carry on, that are really no longer germane to the conditions that are prevailing. And I began to realize that for instance, to me, having been born before flying for the Wright brothers, to me it was a very extraordinary matter that man could fly. And certainly his first flying was fraught with a great deal of danger. And you admired very much the people who were able to accomplish it without failing. And my first automobiles that I had, my first automobile, the automobile tires with my first car would probably blow out within 100 miles. You were stopping really very, very frequently, getting out and taking off that tire and repairing it, ways of vulcanizing it and getting back on. We didn't have the easy mounting tires we have today. It was a very great task to do it. The engine contender broke down, brakes burned out and wore out very rapidly, so that driving a car, doing your own cranking and cleaning your own spark plugs, and often taking out the spark plugs and priming it with gasoline so you get the engine going, you're with your machine. And because you, if you were into it, you knew how relatively unreliable it was. And therefore, you drove with great caution. I still drive in the terms of brakes that fade out. And I allow certain distances. I find my space that I'm allowing to the next car being inviting young people who have good brakes and assume that they have good brakes, that they can dare to drive into that spot with great safety. Now, that would be typical, really, of the difference between people born under one set of conditions and those born under others. What seems safe, what seems logical. It's a very amazing matter to me when my own daughter, Allegra, was born the year that Lindbergh flew across the Atlantic Ocean, but flying was still a very infrequent experience for the average human being to view an airplane actually in flight. You went to air meets, you knew that there were battles of half a dozen planes over Europe during World War I, but the Lindbergh flight was great news to everybody. The biplane was still the major ship, and I was feeling my child in the baby carriage in Chicago's Lincoln Park in 1927, and she was lying on her back looking at the sky, and suddenly a little biplane went overhead. And it was a very extraordinary matter to have an airplane show up over Chicago. And I said, isn't this amazing? My daughter is born with an airplane in the sky. To her, an airplane will seem very logical. Her daughter was born 21 years ago, and she was born in New York, and her father and mother took her to, it's my granddaughter, took her to their new home on a place called Riverdale, just north of Manhattan Island, across the bridge in north of Manhattan Island, to get quite high land. It was called Riverdale, it's quite high. And there was that old wooden house at about the highest point there, and a three-story house, and my daughter and her husband had an apartment on the top floor of that wooden house. Had old-fashioned glass porches on it, and my granddaughter, lying in her crib, was coming right over Riverdale. Was LaGuardia field traffic, all the westbound flights flying in the prevailing southwest or westerly winds, took off right over their house, so that literally every 30 seconds, my granddaughter would hear going over the roof and everybody say airplane to her. She was not surprised. The first word my granddaughter said was not mom or dad, but air. And the parents and uncles and aunts and grandparents would take her out in their arms onto the glass porch. She was born in the fall, late fall of the year. The leaves were off the trees in New York. She saw, and they get out of the glass porch and point to the airplane, and she saw literally thousands of airplanes before she ever saw a bird. To her, an airplane in the sky was much more normal than a bird. And looking from that glass porch down the West Side Drive of New York went by, and came over the bridge and went through a valley just below their house. She saw millions of automobiles in this first year, and the children's books that she was given where I've farmed pigs, horses, ducks, and all the things that I was brought up with, which seemed absolutely normal to me, because the grown-ups then, these are outside the house, and they kept pointing at them. But my granddaughter had never seen any such things. She'd seen all those airplanes, those automobiles, and a picture of her about the same as a picture of a polio virus. She saw that the grown-ups were enjoying showing to her, so she would laugh along with them. It was absolutely pure cartoon. Now, this is a way in which world really has been changing, and the publishers haven't caught on to that kind of a change, that they were still publishing what's called a child's book. I'll grant there are plenty of people who might have been born where there still were some ducks and pigs, but it was not the prevalent condition anymore, because following World War I, the enormous capacity to produce machinery occurred, and farm machinery was developed in a very big way, and began to do the work on the farm more readily than the human beings could with their muscle, and the people used to have to be where the food grew, or they would perish. But suddenly there was refrigeration, and there was canning, the food could reach them any distance, and they weren't needed on the farm to produce the food, so people were all flowing in the city. So this, my granddaughter's experience was really the dominant experience, by far the majority experience, that she would never have seen these things in that farm book. So I now assume that when people say something is natural, natural is the way they found it when they checked in to the picture. And this picture has been changing incredibly rapidly, and with the society in general going along on all the old rules of cities and customs, where you're seeing a whole lot of each other, which are really irrelevant. And so that's one reason why then the young people of our day began to see things very, very differently from the parents, and to realize that the long traditions and customs were really no longer appropriate. And it wasn't a matter of unfriendliness of a young generation with an older generation, just simply that the new generation was being born into a new natural, which was absolutely unnatural to the grown-ups. That's enough of what I'm saying to introduce the concept of there being very large pattern changes affecting the lives of human beings on board of our planet that were not in any way anticipated by any of the humans, yet they are overwhelming and would have to be really read in the terms of being evolutionary, and that universe apparently had it in universe. This was, if you were the first time you were ever a lily, you might assume that you're just going to be a seed, and not realize you're going to then grow up with some green leaves. Then you don't know, all of a sudden you're going to start a white, beautiful bell-shaped flower. And you don't know that you're going to have stamen, and each of these things are a surprise. So that I think humanity as a whole is going through a great transition, which is probably just as superbly designed as is the organization of the human chemistries and the sociability of all those atoms of which we are comprised. And my whole thinking out loud with you from now on is going to relate to seeking for more and more of these large patterns that are operative, which become deprecated by human beings very rapidly because they don't like to seem to have been caught by surprise. And because of that vanity factor, not too easy to make humanity comprehend as possibly readable and significant and predict other such ways to come about. Again, I find human beings really the news that we now are sharing around the world, which all of the world finds disturbing, reporting everybody around the world is aware of troubles of other people as they never were before. They had troubles before, but they're never so aware of the other people's troubles. So we have an awareness of a totality of great trouble. And I think human beings' vanity factor, making them really feel, I am solely responsible how this is going to come out. And I can then deputize my authority to one political leader, and it's up to him to really get us out, or half a dozen that we elect and expect performance, as if human beings really can master and understand in a great way that I feel they do not. I think, to me, it's been clearly manifest that we've been very, very innocent, and that we do respond, we have to respond to the environment, whatever the environment is doing. And we can only do, I don't have a word for instance, artificial. I don't have a word unnatural. I say, if nature permits it, it is natural. If nature doesn't permit it, you can't do it. You may not be familiar with the fact that nature allows that. But the fact that your unfamiliarity doesn't make it unnatural. And if it's unfamiliar to us, we tend to say it's artificial or unnatural. So I'm going to have, I'm going to review two or three ways in which I discipline myself to try to get myself thinking in a little more adequate manner concerning what we know of our universe and what may be going on in a larger way, and to try to get things a little better proportion. As for instance, I would like to have a picture of our Milky Way great galaxy. May I have this picture, please? And here is, we're looking at an array of stars. You can see the Milky Way running through the stars. The number of stars we're looking at is about 18,000. And they're approximately 1/6 millionth of all the stars in our Milky Way galaxy. We now know and we've been able to get our great telescopes trained on other galaxies and so forth. We now have taken photographs and are aware of a billion such galaxies of 100 billion stars each. This picture we're looking at a galaxy very far away. May I have that next picture? And we're looking at an exploding phenomena. This looks to all, I spoke about those 100 million, a million galaxies of 100 million stars each. 99.9% of them are invisible to our naked eye. But their sizes are great, great magnitude. Get a little idea, our own star, Sun, is our own Earth, 8,000 miles diameter, and the diameter of the Sun is just 100 times that. And so our little Earth looks very tiny against that enormous big ball. But our star, Sun, is a small star. Most of you are familiar with Orion's belt. And in Orion's belt, one of the two bright stars is reddish in color, and this is Betelgeuse. And Betelgeuse's diameter is greater than the diameter of the orbit of the Earth around the Sun. So that's a good-sized star. So we are a little planet, a rather inferior star, which is one of 100 billion stars in our galaxy. And we know of a billion such galaxies. So get an idea, our little planet, and you and I are utterly invisible on it. We take pictures of our planet coming in from the sun, from the moon. When you see through the cloud cover, you can see the blue of the waters and brown of the land. You can't make them a human being. You can't even make out a mountain, let alone a human being. There's absolutely no visibility of a mountain, because the aberration of the deepest water and the five miles below sea level, 5 miles above the mountaintop, 10 miles aberration, and 8,000 miles is so meager that a polished steel ball would probably be rougher than that. So that we are absolutely invisible on a really a negligible little tiny planet of a rather negligible star in which is one member of 100 billion out of a known billion such, so multiply the billion times 100 billion, get a little idea. Now, as we look at things a great distance, and this picture that I have of a bursting phenomena in the heavens, which looks like a tiny little light, and keeps remaining like a tiny light, but it's such a distance, and the distances involved are so great. This particular phenomena is expanding at a velocity of 3 million miles an hour. This is the distance between the Earth and the Sun, 92 million, so that in 30 hours, just a little over a day, this expands a complete distance between the Earth and the Sun. And yet it remains for the thousands of years we may be looking at it, like a little tiny speck there in the sky. You get a little sense of the size and the deceptiveness to us that in the magnitude of the information we're really dealing in today. I'm quite confident in it, this is then just as far as you and I have been able to, and I say you and I mean all our fellows, the human beings have been born naked and helpless and finally have discovered principles of refraction of light and have developed the telescope and have been able to make a sweep out. We're getting information, tiny as we are. We have information of approximate spherical sweep out of observation of a 11.5 billion light year radius. And light year is 6.5 trillion miles, so when you get to 11.5 billion times 6.5 trillion, you get an idea of the distance you and I are getting information from, reliable information. So we get the rate at which this thing is expanding. And we through the spectroscope, we've learned about refraction of light, and through the spectroscope, we're able to take the light from all those observations. And each chemical element has its unique frequencies when incandescent, and been able then to, little human beings on our planet, been able to take inventory, the relative abundance of chemical elements in the sweep out of an 11.5 billion year observation. But we have that kind of capability, despite our absolutely negligible magnitude physically, that we can deal with our minds in such magnitudes and do so quite reliably. Gives a hint that the human being must have some very great significance in this scheme, because we don't know of any other phenomena that has this mind, the human mind. And because what I talk about is discoverable only by virtue of the mind. All there are a great many creatures that have brains, and all the creatures that have brains disclose that the brains are always and only synchronizing, integrating a plurality of information from touchings and smellings and hearings, and coordinating those into some composite information that tends to produce images. But the brain is always and only, as each of those senses are, dealing with each special case experience. This is the smell of that one, this is the height of that one, touch, whatever it may be. We find the mind, human mind, able to do something that the brain cannot do. So I differentiate between brain and mind completely. What mind is able to do, human mind is able to do, is from time to time revealing the special case experiences, because they are recallable, and the brain is very good about calling them back, calling them up again. As you review a plurality of those special case experiences, from time to time, mind has intuited. There's something going on, some relationship between the special case experiences that was not being predicted or suggested in any way by any of the special case experiences considered only by themselves. I just take the very extraordinary experience while we're dealing in stars of the fact, well recorded in the earliest annals of man, that he became aware of there being five lights in the sky, five of those points of light, quite bright ones, much smaller than the sun and the moon. And these five bright ones behaved in ways that all the other myriad of little lights did not. The other myriad of lights stayed in very beautiful constant patterns, as far as human beings could see. But five of them moved around, and they were a little brighter than the others, and they moved around in some strange kind of way. And they became, if you kept track of them, they would reappear. And so they had some regularities about them, so that long, long ago, in Mesopotamia, Egypt, Greece, good recordings were made of these behaviors of what we began to call the planets. So there were five special case informations that were doing, there was, had some relationship, it seemed, because they were behaving the way nothing else behaved. So they differentiated out by this unique behavior. We have the then the human beings gradually acquiring calculating capability. And I'd like to make great note of this. We will go back and talk about it in much more detail later on. But if you ever try to do any multiplication or division with Roman numerals, you find you don't get anywhere. So supposing you were intrigued by some motions or something like that, you couldn't make any calculations with Roman numerals. So that no matter how intrigued you might be by the fact that something going on is, I'd like to know something about it, you really know where you can calculate. The Arabic numerals came into the Mediterranean world and began to supplant the Roman numerals about 700 A.D. But they were used at first entirely as shorthand for, say, a set of three marks of the Roman numerals. You just go like that. It's a little quicker. So they were sort of shorthand for this larger scratching. But I want you to realize that the Roman numerals were used entirely as scoring devices. And a man, you could have a servant that's very ignorant, but you, as you station me and say, every time one of those sheep go by, I want you to make a scratch. So he kept doing this faithfully, just matching, scoring, matching of experiences. The Arabic numerals, I'm quite confident, were derived from the invention of the abacus as a calculating device. And if you are familiar with the abacus, with having rods and beads that slide on them, and you can do it with fours and fives, the different module systems you could use, you would then, if you're handling things, what we call decimally or finger-wise, with five, you'd have fill up a column of five, then you'd knock them back again, empty it, and move one over into the next column. And the convention is to move the incrementation to leftward. And when you then closed out the five and moved and put the one over the next column to take its place of those five, then you had an empty column. I'm quite certain that the navigators and the over the great deserts, or the navigators of the sea, who did deal in the stars as the only way to give them information about where they are, probably developed the first trigonometry and the first important geometrical calculations, did then, from time to time, lose their abacus overboard on the ship or lost in the sands. But being so familiar with it, they could draw a picture of it, they could see it in their mind's eye very nicely, and they could then manipulate the concept of filling up that column and then moving over one, I'm quite certain that the Arabic numerals represented a symbol for the content of the column. And when they moved over and left an empty column, they had to have the cipher. So the Arabic numerals had the cipher. It's interesting then, as the Arabic numerals were first taken over in the Mediterranean world as substitutes for the Roman numerals, the cipher had no significance whatsoever, because you couldn't eat no sheep, so you didn't have a score for no sheep, so they didn't have any need in the Roman numerals, just being a score, for something called nothing. So that the cipher was recognized as being there, the Arabic numerals, but just thought it was a decoration, so it was used like a period at the end of the, I'll just put that at the end, or something like that. It is a matter of the slowness of information gain that there's 500 years between the Arabic numerals coming into the Mediterranean world and beginning to take the place of the Roman numerals before the significance of the cipher was discovered and published by a Latin in North Africa, in Latin, then showing how it then occasioned the positioning of numbers, the moving of your multiplication over one column. And with it came the capability of anybody to calculate. Now, calculation had been very much monopolized by the navigator, and the priests, who were unquestionably astronomer navigators who came up on the land. And the temporal power had to come to them, and they found that the temporal power, while it's a strong man, just could not cope with the kind of information they could obtain by virtue of their calculating capability, so they guarded it very carefully. We have the temporal power, if you think about something like Italy, where you see all those great castellos, valley after valley, hill after hill, with a castle commanding its particular valley. And you have little kingdoms all over, the city-state kingdoms were everywhere around that Mediterranean world. And the king or the overlord, whatever you want to call himself, would have the people bring in their sheep and their wheat and whatever it may be, their foods, their produce. And they would want to exchange it so they could go home with some of the other produce. And all the exchanging was calculated at the church. The priest did the calculating for them. And he probably used abacus. But at any rate, the process of having the temporal power vested in the church, the calculating capability, required then that the church also then, in effect, tax the people for making the calculation. So you'd give so many sheep to him and so many bags of wheat to him, but you left bags of wheat and the bags of wheat and sheep out back of the church. So that there was a very large take on the part of the temporal power by virtue of controlling the calculation. As a consequence, with the publication of this book explaining the way in which you position numbers, illiteracy was rampant, so not too many people could read it. But it became very much a threat that anybody could do their own calculation, not have to go to the authorities to do the calculation for them. So that in many, many of those little kingdoms throughout the Mediterranean world, it became a death penalty if anybody caught using the cipher. The word cipher has a secret connotation for this reason. Because people use it, they needed to use it. I've got to do my own calculation, but if I get caught, I must be very secretive with it. Gradually, the significance of the cipher permeates society, particularly the young student world that was literate. So the students of northern Italy and southern Germany began to realize more and more the significance of that cipher and the positioning of numbers to do their own calculations. So young people's faces are less familiar than the older people's faces, so that young people could get away where the older people can't. So with approximately 500, it was 500 years after the Arabic numerals come into the Mediterranean world that the treatise is written, that's 1200, and 300 years later, it is impossible to ever again enforce the prohibition against use of the cipher. And this is a wonderful date, 500, talking about 1500, 500 years ago. And this is exactly when Copernicus comes in. Here was a Copernicus suddenly with the capability to calculate. And calculating the positions and some of the interrelationships of these, of what we call those planets, he came to the conclusion that our Earth was also a planet and behaving in relation to the Sun the way the other planets were. This opened up a completely new excitation of humanity. Remember now I'm saying, his brain getting all this special case business, and mind intuitively stimulated that there must be something going on here. I'd like to find out what it is that is going on. And suddenly we have this calculating capability, and Copernicus coming out with a very new, fantastically new idea that we were not standing still with all this show going around us, but that we were one of the planets of that sun. And we have then Tycho Brahe, very inspired by Copernicus, and man of great means, and acquired instruments for much better observation, and he had his great observer was Kepler, and Kepler then made extraordinary new, much more accurate observations of the planets, and began to be able then to say considerable. First place he discovered they were moving in ellipses and not in circular orbits. If you yourself have ever made an experiment of just drawing a circle, having a pen and a string and a pencil, you know that you have a single restraint. But if you want to make an ellipse, you have two restraints. So the fact that they were moving in ellipses indicated that there was not only some relationship to the sun, but to some other, possibly some integrated effect of the other planets. And Kepler then now had beautiful diagrams which showed that they were a team, all right. They're all going around the sun, but they were different sizes. They were different distances from the sun. They all went around the sun at different rates. So the team was a very disorderly team. And yet he felt that the fact that they were all on one team, they must have something more about them. But now that he had his calculating capability, he then did what a mathematician can do. He said, I want to find something common to these. I can't, superficially, there's nothing common to them. They're all different. But I'm going to give them an amount of time very much less than one orbit of the fastest orbiting. So I think, as I remember, the amount of time was 21 days. And now he knew how far they were from the sun, each one. So on the beginning of that 21 days, he's here, and then he knows the exact amount of arc in 21 days. Then he has the radius from the end of that arc back to the sun again. Makes a piece of pie shape area. He found the same 21 days. Some of them were short, fat pie, and some were long, thin pie. But because he had the actual mathematical data, he was then able to calculate the areas of the piece of pie. Extraordinary intuition must have made him do such a thing. Must have said, as long as I have the data, I might as well calculate it. And it was an absolute astonishment. He found the areas were all exactly the same as given amount of time. So while there was superficial difference, I want you to try to think of yourself being the first human being. Having all this stimulation going on for thousands of years, to suddenly realize that hidden in the superficial disorder was the most incredible, elegant mathematical order. Absolute coordination. And he would have to reason that if they were touching each other, you could understand how gears could coordinate. But the incredible distance is intervening. How could they possibly coordinate with this elegant mathematical manner? But one thing you could say about that was that they were these great distances apart, and he knew that if he had a weight on a string and swung it around his head, it was in an orbit. If it let go, it seemed to go off in a line. The fact that they were in orbits indicated there was some kind of a tensive restraint. So he really got down to that. There's a tensive restraint, and it could be that the other planets got in various positions where there was a composite of their poles to affect, bring about this elliptical phenomenon. We have Galileo, like other brains then, terribly stimulated by experiences, but suddenly with calculating capability. So he began to measure the rates at which objects would go down inclined planes of different angles than free-falling bodies. And found these free-falling bodies were increasing in their rate of falling. There was acceleration. And found the rate at which they're accelerating was actually multiplying the number times itself to the second power rate of acceleration. We have then Isaac Newton, enormously stimulated by all the foregoing events of all these other discoverers, and he himself also then with mathematical capability. And he had a deep drive to somehow understand that tensive relationship Kepler had discovered. And he himself then, like you and I, could swing a weight around his head, and every time he let it go off like that, then he sent it off in a line like that, but the Earth pulled on it and pulled it that way. Quite clearly, the Earth was much more powerful than he was in sending it this way. Isaac Newton then involved his first law of motion. The body would persist in a straight line, except as affected by other bodies. And he said, I see this other body, the Earth, is very, very powerful. Something to do, how much they pull must have something to do with their sizes. And he then said, I am informed by the astronomers and the navigators, we have very good information regarding the interrelationships of the moon and the Earth, the tides, the three quarters of the Earth that cover the water, how those waters are pulled by the moon. So that trillions of tons of water being lifted by the moon pull, obviously the pull between them is something vastly greater than my muscles are involved. So it's something to do with size here. Then Isaac Newton, having evolved his first law of motion, the body would persist in a straight line except as affected by other bodies. He then conceived hypothetically, which a mathematician can do with it, he has his calculating capability. The patterns of the heavens were very well charted by now by the astronomers and the navigators. And for any given minute of any night of the year, you knew exactly what the patterns would be, what would be in zenith over any given point. That's how you can navigate. So Isaac Newton had some very reliable patterns of the heavens to go by for a given time. So he chose a night when the moon would be in the full, easy to observe, and probably clear weather. And then he made an assumption that the Earth would be suddenly stop pulling on the moon. As in effect, he doesn't use those words, that you would annihilate the Earth. Therefore, unless you have that weight and swing around your head, if you let go of it, it goes off this line. So he said, if the Earth suddenly stopped pulling on the moon, the moon would go off on a given line. So he calculated what that line would be on that night at that time. And he was able then to pattern it against the heavens. A clearly patternable line. Therefore, on that night, at that time, he then measured the rate at which the moon was falling away from that line towards the Earth. And he found the rate which was falling was exactly agreed with Galileo's rate of falling bodies, that there's an accelerating rate, and moving apparently the second power, as multiplying the number times itself. Therefore, he said, number one, we multiply the two masses times each other to get the relative amount of interpole compared to between any other two objects. And we halve the distance between the two, we'll increase the interattractiveness fourfold, that is, the second power. He spoke about how it's been in inverse ratio, because he spoke about going away, so if you go twice as far away, it's only one quarter of the pull. So he had the inverse ratio of the second power, the relative proximity. There were relatively very few literate people in his day. Very few people really listened to what he was saying. But the other astronomers did pay attention and began then to apply his hypothetical relationship to other astronomical phenomena. Gradually, began to discover, always explained all the astronomical interbehaviors of these remote bodies. So we have then suddenly human mind, all these various minds of the generations, of many generations, stimulated by something going on there between that's not of, wasn't in any one of those planets by itself at all. And we have then Isaac Newton finding this interrelationship, which has proved to be absolutely valid and holds, as we even get in the microcosm long after, when Isaac Newton didn't know we were going to get in there at all, there's no electromagnetics involved, this mass and attractiveness is operative. Isaac Newton was able to say that these two apples wouldn't pull towards each other, therefore you and I on the planet would not tend to think about this interpull, because the pull of the Earth is so enormous as the friction of the apples on the table completely prevent any demonstration of any local two bodies pulling towards each other. So one reason escape maps so long had to be these free bodies, a great remove that would have to stimulate man to think this way. Now, what I'm coming to then is that there was nothing in the moon in its geometrical dimensions, there was nothing in its chemistry, there was nothing in its electromagnetics, that anyway said it was going to attract the Earth. There was nothing, the Earth had said the same. It was not until you saw the inner behavior being manifested in free space that you realized something was going on between. Now, this is when, what I said, mind and mind alone has been able to discover relationships that are existing between that are not of any of the special case phenomena. And brain is always dealing in special case. So brains are dealing in special case and mind is dealing in discovering relationships existing between. This is then comes to the word synergy. Synergy means behaviors of whole systems, and a minimum system would be two. Behaviors of whole systems are predicted by behavior of any of the parts of the system when those parts are considered separately, one from the other. And the word synergy I found going around the world, speaking to, I've spoken to 500, a little more than 500 colleges and universities around the world. The first 300, I checked my audiences, asking how many are familiar with the word synergy, and less than 3%, and popular audiences about 1%. So it became evident to me the word synergy was not popular, but is the only word that means behavior of a whole system unpredicted by behavior of any of the parts considered only separately. The fact then that the great inner behaviors, in fact, all great generalized principles discovered by science are the our relationships existing between that are not of the parts themselves. That's why these scientific discoveries are few and far apart, because they are, you're always just finding relationships. And these relationships can only and always be expressed mathematically. They're completely generalizable mathematically. So I find that in the universe is quite clearly these important generalized principles which we discover. A generalized principle in science is one which no exception has ever been found to the mathematics of the principle. And a generalized principle then, our brains are always dealing in each special case, and each special case is inherently terminal, finite, centropic, physical. Therefore, brain wants to have things begin and end, and brain would like to have a beginning and an end of the universe, a beginning and end of the world. But mind then discovers principles which must have no exception, which means that they're inherently eternal, and not the kind of word that brain is familiar with. But it's implicit that they are eternal. They must have never any exception. We find then plurality of these eternal generalized principles operative. And if you become then preoccupied with the family of known generalized principles, then you become deeply impressed to realize that being eternal, they're all concurrently operative, and none of them has ever been found to contradict any of the others. In fact, they're all found to be inter-accommodative. Now, they all have absolute regularities, and the regularities are inter-accommodative. When you and I use the word design, we use it to mean a complex in which the various components are ordered in respect to the one with the other. That's a design in contradiction to randomness. There's a deliberate placement and ordering. So I'd say then, human mind is gradually discovering, if you're looking at a plurality of the generalized principles, a great a priori design of universe. And that human mind has access to the rules and the design of universe, a little glimpse of it, because we keep pulling the curtain aside, realize there's a lot more that we don't know. what is most impressive really about this whole experience I just gave you of an Isaac Newton or Kepler is that he asked Mr. Newton what the gravity is. He's able to tell you how it behaves. He said, I can't possibly tell you what it is because there's nothing in any data, any specification you point to that says it's going to happen. Absolutely nothing. Therefore, when you come to the great moments, the actual fact of how great generalized principles are discovered, you come to a priori absolute mystery, within which a priori absolute mystery, this most sublime and reliable relationship is manifest as existing. So to me, the more intimate you become with the actual working moments of those who made the great discoveries, the more deeply moved you are by an a priori great mystery. I'm going to have a break for a little while. I think that it's quite hot inside here, and everybody's getting fairly affected by the heat. So let's have a little air. Since the great generalized principles that have been discovered by science are synergetic, I'd like to just think about the word synergy a little more. And as I said, I found audiences, the university audiences around the world, approximately unfamiliar, only 3%, and 1% of the popular audience. Therefore, it's perfectly clear that the word not being popular, which would tell me that people are not thinking that there are behaviors of wholes unpredicted by behaviors of past, because if they did think there were, then they would have to find the word to express it. And the word synergy is that word. The fact that it's unfamiliar makes it quite clear to me society has become quite content that all you have to know is about parts. Society has been quite content to be specialized, feeling that the parts are all going to add up, take care of themselves. So I'd like to think a little more about that word synergy. The word is the companion of the word energy. Energy, synergy. The ergy, the work, the S-Y-N, and the S-Y-N of synchronization. It's the withness prefix. It's the integrating prefix, as the energy was the separating out, differentiating out. Now, the word energy is very familiar to man, because he has been then quite content to separate out. He felt that he gained by isolating scientifically, he discovered, and he has discovered certain amounts by that. He got a great deal of data by isolating, but he hasn't found these great principles by the isolation. And right. Energy has been a preoccupation of man, and synergy has been really overlooked. But synergy is to energy what as integration is to differentiation. Energy is differentiating out, and synergy is integrating. There is nothing in atoms per se that predicts chemical compounding. There's nothing in chemical compounds per se that predicts biological protoplasm. There's nothing in biological protoplasm per se that predicts camel and palm tree and the respiratory exchange of gases between the mammals and the vegetation. In fact, you discover that the larger complex of universe is never being predicted by the lesser. There's nothing in chemistry of human toenail that predicts human being. So I find then that the universe itself is synergetic. It is a great complex of generalized principles, each of which is synergetic. So that we really have a synergy of synergy. There is an exponential synergizing of the generalized principles of the universe themselves. Now, quite clearly then, the universe being complex and synergetic if we were able then to cope with the totality, we might be able to find out about parts, and we have what I call three well-known synergetic strategies of obtaining important information. First is a Greek triangle, where the triangle having six distinct parts, the three angles and three edges. And the known sum of the angles of the triangle, 180, plus then the any two sides known and the included angle known, you can find out, you know, half the information, you get the other half. Be able to get half that's all unknown before is a very powerful capability. We find then the you can always institute in trigonometry, you can always invent a right triangle in any triangle, because you can drop a perpendicular line to a baseline that's going to be 90 degrees. And you can divide any triangle into two right triangles. And with having two rights, you then are able, you know one of those angles is right, therefore gives you a whole lot of information right away, plus 180 degree known. And we'll only have to find out two other items in order to be able to solve your problems with the trigonometry. Now, there was then the Greek triangle is a synergetic strategy, working for the whole, the known behavior of the whole, the known behavior of some of the parts, finding out about other parts. Into the synergetic strategies comes, relatively short time ago, historically, Euler. And Euler realized an extraordinary pattern generalization. Euler doesn't phrase it in these words, but I'm giving you my own phrasing of what Euler said. He said, all visual experiences can be reduced to three fundamental aspects. There are visual experiences of trajectories. Something is in motion, leaves a trail. Or I scratch, that's leaving a trail. Or I leave a deposit of amount of chalk, that's a trail. There are trajectories, and where two trajectories cross, we get a fix. That gives you a location. And a parallel lines cross, so the same line comes back and crosses itself and has then a perimeter, a closure, then you have areas. And he said, lines and areas and crossings or fixes are never to be confused one with the other, and all visual experiences are reducible into those three. So you look at any picture you've ever seen, and I will say it does not include the color. It could be any color. Looking at that picture, you can say, I would consider that line, that's an outline of a face. You could decide that this is a point, a crossing and a point would be the same. You say if it's a point, it is not an area. But if the point is big enough, you think it's an area, you make a line around it. And Euler found that when you then decided what it is you're looking at in the picture, you take inventory, that is a line, that is an area, and that is a crossing. Then, he said, the numbers of the crossings, which he also, because lines are crossing, they're converging as they cross, therefore called vertex, coming towards one another, indicating, working towards a point. So he said the numbers of vertexes plus the numbers of areas, if it's a flat picture on the wall, will equal the number of the lines plus the number one. But if he said, if you recognize that a picture on the wall, the wall is a part of some kind of a polyhedral phenomena. So if I say then the picture then has an edge and a back to it, and these would be very asymmetrical polyhedra, but that whole blackboard and its wheels and such. And now, if I then deal in what I'm looking at as a polyhedron, then he said that the numbers of the crossings plus the numbers of areas will equal the numbers of the lines plus the number two. It'd be absolutely constant. Then he said, if you put a hole through the system, like put a hole in a donut or coring an apple, then the numbers of the crossings or vertexes plus the number of areas equal to the numbers of the lines. Well, this is a very extraordinary kind of a total capability now. You know a behavior of a hole. This is all there isn't any more. And if you know some of that there, you find out the others. Then we have, in chemistry, Willard Gibbs. Willard Gibbs said that crystalline liquids and gases states, that these had an interrelationship we call as phase rule, which was very similar then to the Euler. This plus this equals this plus two. And I've now been able, as I will go on with you in the hours and days to come, I'm going to give you then the topological identification of the Willard Gibbs phase rule. That's not the appropriate time for us to do it here, but what I'm getting at is I've given you three grand strategies, synergetic strategies, where you know the behavior of a whole. This is everything you observe about the whole, and you know some of the parts, you find out about other parts. Now this is a very, very powerful matter. I find that our whole educational system around the world is organized on the basis of the little child being ignorant. Assuming that the little child that's born is going to have to be taught, in the sense it's kind of an empty container, waiting for information to be given to it from the grown-ups. And so the little child demonstrates time and again an interest in the whole universe. The child is very enthusiastic about the planetarium. The little child asks most beautiful questions about total universe, continually embarrassing the grown-ups who have become very specialized and can't ask the great comprehensive questions. We find the child then, with his propensity to comprehend totally, really to be synergetic. The humans have this proclivity to be synergetic, and yet our education is to say, never mind darling about that universe, come in here and I'm going to give you an A and a B and a C. And then if you learn that, well, I'll give you a D and E and F. You keep adding to the parts. We do what we call building up a body of knowledge, a brick on brick. This all both perplexed me and stimulated me into thinking about how we might somehow or other reorganize our self-education. Because education is, in the end, a self-educating. The experiences stimulate, but then the significance in the experience has to be apprehended and then comprehended by the individual. And the synergetic educational system then became of great excitation to me, and I wondered how we might be able then to it seemed logical, if you could, to start with the universe itself. Let's start with the whole, and then we'll have no variables left out. So I felt that I'd have to have a definition of universe. And incidentally, as I disciplined myself along these lines, starting almost a half century ago, I said I must never use a word that I cannot really relate to experience. I must be able to define each word that I use. In fact, I don't have a good definition going back to experience. I must give it up. So I said, I've either got to give up the word universe or define it in an experiential basis. Now, the founder, Eddington, defining universe, Eddington defining science, and he said, science is the attempt to set in order the facts of experience. The raw material is experience. I found another very great scientist, and I'm quite certain that he was unaware of Eddington's statement. I could not certify this, but the man was relatively remote, and it was Ernst Mach, the physicist of Vienna. And Ernst Mach, the physicist of Vienna, is a man whose the name Mach number, is, when we come to ultrasonic speed, was named for Mach, Ernst Mach. Mach, the physicist, said, physics is arranging experience in the most economical order. Because the physicist has discovered that absolutely unique to nature is that nature always does things in most economical ways. There are many ways of talking about this, the principle of least resistance or whatever, the least effort, but it's always most economical. However, this is not a yes, no, stop, go affair. We find, as you're going to go on with me, that there are a plurality of equi-economical alternatives optional to every event in the universe. There's a plurality of them. But as Mark said, nature will use one of those most economical, equally most economical. So the physicist then was concerned with economy of arrangement of the experiences, and Eddington, the scientist general, interested in experience, all experiences. And he didn't specify, he said, arranging experiences in order. Now, a mathematician such as Boole developed a concept of mathematicians to a little further degree, where the mathematicians have been unable to find any grand strategy approach to gain information from in a logical manner. They find it expedient to then assume the most absurd condition, and then gradually eliminate the improbability of the utterly absurd, this is less absurd, to get down to something that might be reasonable, at least as a way of sharpening up this reductio ad absurdum. We have then a bull able to introduce not economical orders. I just want to understand. The general science might then try to put experiences in order, but they may not be most economical. The difference between the physicist and the mathematician then would be the physicist is only interested in those most economical, because those are the only ones who really correspond to the way nature is behaving. The absurd is what nature doesn't do. What's a good, it's very fortuitous on the part of the mathematician to employ such a strategy. Now, we have Einstein saying the beginning and in the end is his experience. The experience becomes quite clearly the raw material of all science. And this we mean by it is experimentally evidenceable. And once you learn how it behaves, you're going to be able to repeat the experiment, and there that behavior is manifest. So that I then felt that it'd be very necessary to describe universe in the terms of experience. So I said, what do I mean by the word universe? I said, I must mean the aggregate of all of humanity's consciously apprehended and communicated experiences. That'd be the whole raw stuff. What else could I mean? And at first when I said that quite a few years ago, I know I myself and many others felt maybe it's inadequate. You've left something out there. They said, you've left out dreams. I said, no, it's part of it. I said, the aggregate of all of our experience. We have experienced dreaming. We also experience becoming. We've experienced the dictionary, the numbers of words in the dictionary increase every day because it's part of our experience. We're continually discovering another facet to the information. So I can't find anything that's been really left out of the definition. And if you can find anything, tell me about it. It's already going to be one of our experiences. So that it seems to work pretty well. Having then developed a scientific definition of universe, I then said, I have a way now of dealing in totality. I know what it is. I find it very interesting that Einstein then sought and did define physical universe in contradistinction to comprehensive universe, because he differentiated between the physical and the metaphysical. And he said he was only concerned really with the physical, because the physical can be coped with experimental evidence, through reproduced experiment. But I also say that you and I do have metaphysical experiences. He defined science, or rather, his physical energy. Physical is energy. Energy associative and energy dissociative, and both turn aroundable. That the dissociative could become dissociative could become associative. That radiation could be reflected and lands and reconcentrated and so forth. So that Einstein's physical universe consisted entirely of energy. Energy associative as matter, energy dissociative as the radiation. And one transformable into the other. We have then the physical universe of Einstein being all energetic. As he said, it used to be called ponderable, that it was weighable. But we find that weighing is then the effect on of a lever, and there is then gravity can pull, but electromagnetics can pull equally. So when we get in electromagnetics, we simply say that anything that is physical can be identified by moving a needle. Now we can get actually a physical indicator of the presence of the physical. But the metaphysical is does not move needles. Now the metaphysical experience is a very profound one. All that's going on in this room with you, between you and I, has been metaphysical. What we might call understanding is utterly metaphysical. There are no arrows. There is nothing going on to really to weigh or indicate really understanding. I find it's a very extraordinary matter. I can see your eye physically, and your eye will communicate to me as my tongue can wag and make sounds in the airwaves, which gives you some kind of words and so forth. But the understanding is not that physical. So Einstein did not try to include the metaphysical in his definition of universe, but he defined the physical universe the following way, stimulated by experiences of which had come in great prominence in his time, the turn of the century, where he was very much impressed by what he called the Brownian movement, this absolute constant motions in the liquids. He was very impressed with black body radiation, but he was particularly impressed by the measurement of the speeds of radiation, both light and other forms of radiation, in vacuo, linearly in vacuo, and finding that they were all the same speed. I want to identify what he thought about these stimulants that I gave you in the terms of previous thinking proclivities of humans. We have the human beings over great ages seeing smoke, seeing steam in nature, seeing metals melted out of rock. We have a very extraordinary time when Priestley, the priest scientist, undertook to isolate fire under a bell jar, because up to this time there had been four mystical elements, the air, earth, water, and fire. And he felt that fire might be a chemical element, and he gave it a temporary working name, and he then set about to isolate this fire under the bell jar. And he weighed the items that he was going to ignite, and then ignited them, and when the fire was over, they found that the products on there weighed more than the weight of what they'd put in. We have Lavoisier explaining what had happened in the following manner. He said that they had not weighed the air under the jar. Up to this time, all the chemical elements been known to human beings were metals. They were iron, copper, silver, zinc, so forth. There were 11 of them. And they're very easy to identify. For Lavoisier to say that the nothingness under the bell jar consisted of plurality of invisible chemical elements, and that one of them is separated out and joined in with the other inputs of the fire, separating from the other, and he gave it the name oxygen. But this was, to me, one of the most extraordinary metaphysical jumps in history for a human being to assume that the non-metal nothingness consisted of plurality of something, and something so fundamental as to be actually rated as elements. It was extraordinary conception. He then went on to show this exactly, the oxygen joined with the mercury, mercury oxide. He showed that what we call iron ore was something, when the oxygen had joined, you take the oxygen away and there's your iron. He went on demonstrating this, oxygen joining, so that combustion really was oxidation. So we have then Lavoisier's explanation then enlightened all those who'd ever had an experience really about metallurgy. You'd had good luck in having fire and melting metals out, but suddenly it gave chemical controls to metallurgy. It also explained what combustion was. It also explained what steam was, because there's water vapor, where he had the associating of the oxygen. Out of this, you could not have avoided inventing the steam engine out of the new metal and atmosphere of science. And the steam engine came along very shortly. And with the steam engine, the masters of the water ocean world, three-quarters of it covered with water, with the lands all divided, and the men who had enough power to command the carpenters and the metal workers and so forth, produce a ship and build a great ship, having developed this design of it through eons of experience of the sea, gradually learning what did constitute a big, good, adequate ship, be able to send it to great distances, integrate the resources of Earth, which were very different in the different parts of the world, bring about synergetic interaction of this in one place and with another. And suddenly, what was at home and didn't seem to have any value until suddenly has a very great value. Masters of the water ocean world that suddenly had steam and didn't have to wait for wind in their sails outperformed completely the people who still were just waiting for wind in their sails. We have then the masters of the water ocean world of great wealth, incredible wealth, saying, you scientists, up to this time, energy had just been some kind of a god. Some countries had several kinds of energetic gods, some of speed and mercury, whatever it may be, but they're just gods. And suddenly, you have that energy coming through a pipe with a valve, and you turn it on to do this extraordinary work. And what other kind of capabilities do you scientists have? This is the first time science really came into very important patronage by great wealth. This really brought about the Royal Society and other equally high-standing scientific organizations in the various competing countries of Europe, see who's going to control that water trade. So the scientists then giving this money to the scientists, being given money, developed then, they identified energy uniquely with the heat, with the fire. Therefore, they developed what they call thermodynamics. And with the thermodynamic scientific researching came the great second law of thermodynamics, discovering that the all local systems always continue to lose energy. This phenomenon, entropy. And the energy is given off, maybe oddly, have been given off in an oddly way in respect to that particular system, but the rate at which it's been given off by another system is another periodicity, and so the two coming together do not necessarily synchronize, so they seem to be producing randomness and disorder. Incidentally, I found it very interesting to look up the first law of thermodynamics as formulated in England. It was that the unit of measure of energy should be the British thermal unit, BTU. It's a highly political first law. And the second law was then about entropy. Now, we have the time of Newton. So far as the scientists knew, we had instant universe. And Newton thought of time as a quality permeating all universe at exactly the same rate. So that he scientists said that the clouds get out of the way, they're the stars, the instant stars. There had been a great astronomer, Romer, who, to explain certain astronomical phenomena that he observed, had to assume that could be that light also had a speed the way sound has speed. And Romer's calculations regarding this were very extraordinary. They come in really very close to what was found out experimentally when man on board our planet in vacuo did then, actually with mirrors, develop the speed of light experiments. But the scientists were not thinking Romer's way at all. Scientists in general were thinking instant universe. And because the universe was instant universe, then it too was a system. And with the great second law of thermodynamics, then the universe itself must be losing energy. Therefore, the universe is running down. This is the very essence of classical conservatism. The people who thought they were being well informed by science, that the universe is somehow or other had a big bang. And Isaac Newton also, in his first law of motion, said, I gave you a body persists in a straight line, but his first sentence, first phrase is, a body persists in a state of rest or in a line of motion, except as affected by other bodies. To Isaac Newton, at rest was norm, and all the motions were abnormal. But somehow or other, somebody had this big bang, and the universe is going to expend its energy, and anybody spends it is just going to bring us all to rest a little quicker than rest being death, than normal. It's quicker than death. We have, then, in view of what I've just said to you, Einstein being informed that radiation did have a speed, and astronomers employing this right away, discovering that it took light 8 minutes to come to us, to Earth from the Sun. And I'm going to use items that Einstein did not use, but you're very familiar with the Big Dipper, the Big Bear. And we go in the first star and the end of the handle of the Big Dipper, you're seeing a live show taking place 700 years ago. Excuse me, 75 years ago. We go into the next star at the turn of the handle, you're seeing a live show taking place 100 years ago. And get in one more star and you've got a live show taking place 200 years ago. These are anything but on the same blackboard. Because 100 years difference at 6.5 trillion miles each year. You've got an incredible depth of observation where the brightness makes it seem to be akin in that pattern. Then you look at Andromeda and you can see the little few little sparkling lights of a whole galaxy there. And you're looking at a live show taking place 1 million years ago. It takes exactly 1 million years for that light to get here. Come back again to looking at Orion's belt and the Betelgeuse and the other bright star. One is a live show 1,500 years ago, another 1,100 years ago. So Einstein said the universe is an aggregate of non-simultaneous and only partially overlapping energy events. Each one of these is a great energy event. Each one has its own duration. They have their beginnings and their endings. So we have then this, to him then, the physical universe was an aggregate of non-simultaneous and only partially overlapping energy transformation events. Now, this is a very interesting kind of a definition because it is also the definition of what you and I would call scenario. In a scenario, we have a man born and then he gets to be daddy and he has children, then he gets to be granddaddy. He overlaps the grandchildren and he dies. There is the introduction of a life and it blooms. Like there's a star the same, and the star has its duration. So there are beginnings and endings of these local energy systems. But the energies, Einstein said, I don't think that the, in this non-simultaneous universe, that the energies that are being given off by this one might be associating elsewhere. And he said, I see on board of our planet this little child is not entropic. This little child gets to be a bigger child, doesn't deteriorate, doesn't come apart. There seem to be organisms where there's a growth, and the little sapling gets to be the big tree. So I can see then later on when it begins to shrivel and then shrink and it disappears. There's an overlapping. These energies, then he said, there was another great scientist, Boltzmann. And Boltzmann had the feeling, the concept intuitively, that energies then pulsed in our universe. You and I are familiar with our weather, where we give the weather in the terms of high and low pressures of the atmosphere. And we find that the lows are always exhausting the highs like a vacuum cleaner till they become full, they become the new high and new other lows elsewhere. So Boltzmann had the idea of exporting and importing, that one place becomes exportive, then find exhaust, then some place was importing all the time, so there's a pulsing of the universe, but the energy is not getting lost. So Einstein said, in contradistinction then to conservatives who thought the universe was entropic and nothing else, therefore the universe was running down and coming apart, Boltzmann and Einstein then think in the terms of, could be that the energies dissociating here are associating there. And so out of Einstein's expression of that powerful working hypothesis, it came very much greater attention to energy accounting. And we have then, as of this century, science having to say there was no experimental evidence of energy either being created or being... We do have the word in science, in physics, of annihilation. And many of the words used by the physicists are ill-chosen, I find. As, for instance, the physicist talks about particles, and he said, I don't mean anything at all. This is just an event. But but he's so used to a little something being called a particle, he calls it a particle. So I find it's ill-chosen for him to use the word annihilation. His annihilation is a following kind. I have one rubber glove. There's only one rubber glove in the universe here. It's on my left hand. But I start stripping it off my left hand, and finally I pull it off like that, just gradually rolling it off. And suddenly, it's off my hand, but now the left hand, it fits the right hand. So there's a right hand now, you have a right hand, and then the right hand gets annihilated and has a left hand. One is convex and assembled and focal, and the other is simply, for the moment, invisible. This does not make it annihilated. And all the annihilations that physics has are of that character, that is, they are reinstatable in it. You can go from the positive to the negative. So I have Einstein's thinking and instituting way of thinking, which now, as of this point of the 20th century, makes it really quite clear, as far as experimental evidence goes, universe is eternally regenerative. Now, we have, as Einstein said, each of the energy events. Again, we had this beautiful, the photon. We'd gone down to Planck, we'd gone down to a minimum energy package. And it's a finite package. And he said, absolutely discontinuous from the next package. So he said, the universe is an aggregate of finite. Therefore, the total is finite. An aggregate of finites is finite. But you and I tend to say, the proclivity of man is to say, the finite is viewable, it is seeable, conceptual. Einstein's definition, which I said, comes in the category of scenario. He didn't call it scenario. There have been other scientists who spoke about it as serial universe and so forth, meaning scenario. There was a very, very fascinating English scientist, philosopher, James Dunn, who wrote this serial universe. Now, scenario want you to think about is an aggregate of frames. And there's nothing in the single frame caterpillar that tells you it's going to be a butterfly. There's nothing in one single frame butterfly that tells you the butterfly can fly. You have to have a whole lot of frames of butterfly changing and in relationship to the environment to realize they're flying. You find that in scenario universe, there's no meaning whatsoever until you get a great many of the special case experiences, and there's a little intuition of some relationships going on here. That's why the scenario is so fascinating, because you feel something's there, you're looking for those relationships all the time that are being increasingly suggested as probably present in as one event after another. We have then a scenario universe is then non-unitarily conceptual. Single frames are unitarily conceptual. So the universe is defined by Einstein as non-unitarily conceptual. So we have him, and it is finite because it's an aggregate of finites. And it is eternally regenerative, yet is non-unitarily conceptual. So when you find yourself asking yourself the question, having heard that the astronomers just found a further out star, when you say, I wonder what's outside, outside, you're asking a sculptural question, a single frame. The outside means that you do have a picture, a single one. And that's like asking, which word is a dictionary? It's actually a meaningless question in the terms of scenario universe. Once you realize what it was Einstein was really introducing here. So we have aggregates of finites. Now, I felt that I could expand Einstein's scenario physical universe to also include my metaphysical experiences, because all of those always begin and end. My information stimulus from the brain are always terminal. So all my inputs are finite. So I said, I'm going to define physical and metaphysical universe, which I'd like to do now if I can, so in order to be able to start with the whole, is then, I said, the aggregate of all humanity's constantly apprehended and communicated experiences. You communicate to yourself or to the others, but the experience is not in any way, it has no meaning until we actually try some kind of communication with it. That is its beginning, is a communication. So it is a communication. The experience is a communication. So I said, I think I could combine the metaphysical and the physical by saying it is then the aggregate of all humanity's constantly apprehended communicated experiences, which are an aggregate of non-simultaneous, only partially overlapping events, both metaphysical and physical, energetic as well as metaphysical, weightless. So therefore I said, I see then, universe, all each one of those metaphysical experiences always begins and ends. Our experience is that way. It's the nature of the special casing that they are terminal. Therefore I said, they too are an aggregate of finite. So the universe has to find, both metaphysical and physical combined, is finite but non-unitarily conceptual. So I said, what is then conceptual? And what is thinkable? This brought me then to, I'm now pursuing a grand strategy of having been able now at least to get to a definition of universe. So I got a lot of actual inputs about what it is, knowing its behavior, the whole. What the whole is, and I'm going to get learning, if I can, about some of the parts. Now, or what other parts do I know something about? Well, I come down then to this very extraordinary phenomena you and I call thinking. Throughout the whole of my thinking out loud with you, you're going to find that I always come back to experiential base. I don't deal with any axioms. I don't say anything is self-evident. I don't say anything I believe. I can't hypothesize that this may be what it is, the explanation of what it is we're experiencing, I have to say that is as a guess. It's an informed guess. But I'll always be dealing in an experiential strategy, and I'm now doing everything I can to understand how we can develop a synergetic grand strategy of approaching the approach to problem solving by human mind. So I said, what is it that I am personally conscious of doing when I say I am thinking? I'm not saying thinking may be a bright light suddenly. We often hear people say, yeah, it's a bright idea. I say, what am I conscious of about this? And all that, so I become really fairly well disciplined in identifying what it is I am experiencing. Now, I call your attention to a common experience of all of ours, which is we say, what is the name of that beautiful blonde tall boy, remember? And he did so and so, so and so. Yeah. Great. His name is the tip of my tongue. But it doesn't come right away. And both of us forget we said it. And then tomorrow morning you're very busy or something. In comes your name, Tom Turner, whatever. And you're a little annoyed at the thing. But what we do is we both experience that when we ask ourselves questions, we have a mechanism that goes back and gets the answer. It may be quite difficult to retrieve. It may be hidden under a lot of other inputs, but it can be. We have this mechanism, does it absolutely inexorably. That's a mutual experience. That's one reason why we remember it, because we can check up with each other. It did happen, but we have a solo experience. And I also have learned from doing what I'm doing, thinking out loud and being on the stage many times with large thousands of people out there, and a word doesn't come to me quite right away, because I'm doing that thing out loud, and I have to pull out those word tools that I've gradually learned to employ. And one comes so slowly, and I need to say, explain what it is, and I find I can get around it by using quite a few other words to inform you what I'm thinking about. But then just as I'm getting out that way, then suddenly the right word comes to me. I find that there are lags in recall rates, which we would not really identify, because that name thing seems to come back tomorrow or sometime later on, sometimes today. But such big lags, we haven't been able to say that there's any given identifiable periodicity of lag, a length of lag. However, I've learned that the words that I'm standing on the stage needing, they're rather frequently used words, and every word they use has a little lag, and some of them a little longer lags. Find the people who are not used to thinking about what it is they're doing when they're thinking and talking tend to go in between, really giving a periodicity of the lag. Now, point is that I've discovered there's a plurality of lags and rates of recalls, and some of them are really very short, particularly these ones in relation to the word tools. And the names take longer because the names used to be names of functions, descriptions of Smith was smiting, and the miller was milling. So you could see that by your experience. It came to me very, very quickly. But now when you say miller, he's not doing milling. And it gets to be then just a sound pattern. This Smith is an area of sound, and it's a graphing. And so we only have certain amount of memory cubbyholes for this kind of non-functional pattern, and so they get buried very deep like magazines. So it takes a long time to go down and pull under that stack and that because that cubbyhole's been filled up just vertically now. Now, coming then to the idea that there are lags and rates of recall, and that there is an inexorable searching that is initiated when you ask yourself a question. Well, I said it to you, it's different, but I've asked myself. So I'm going down the street and I say, what is the name of that tree? My mother gave me the name of that tree. I haven't seen one in a very long time. And then your attention is called to something else. Some friend waves from a car and you go on. You ask yourself questions all day long like that. So when you're trying to go to sleep, sometimes in come maple trees and all that, you wonder why these things keep coming in. And because there's no identified lag of different types, they don't come back on schedule, that really makes it possible to say, yes, I asked myself that question 3 hours ago. And just look at my clock, sure enough, it's 3 hours. We don't have that kind of scheduling. So there's a heterogeneity to the rate of recall that does not make us tend to pay much attention to this. We just say, I'm a little slower. We use such words as that. Now, I've now discovered what it is that I do when I say I am thinking. I find that I become spontaneously preoccupied. I don't do that deliberately. I've suddenly realized that's something I've been thinking about quite a lot. I've put off time and again. I really would like to think that out. So I say I'm now going to accommodate my really pursuing. There's some important relationship going on here, but if I only take a little time, I'm going to find out. What understanding means I'm finding the relationships. I'd like to understand what's going on here. So what I do consciously then when I say I'm thinking is that my conscious part is in keep coming messengers with maple trees and things, and I say, that's really very interesting. I'm glad to have that information, but please wait in the anteroom. Don't go away, but wait in the anteroom. So my conscious part is sort of holding this interesting but irrelevant information on one side while I'm parting the grass and finding that path, and suddenly I find out what it is I'm looking for. So my conscious part was dismissing or holding off temporarily irrelevances. Having discovered that my conscious part was then dismissing irrelevances, I then found the irrelevances fell into two main classes. All the experiences which I'm trying to recall and identify to feed in here, all experiences which are too large and too infrequent to in any way be synchronizable with the magnitude that I'm considering. And all the experiences I've had which are too high frequency, too minute to in any way have worthwhile magnitude at the size of it. So I find that really is tuning. There's a much too great a wavelength and much too small a wavelength. This is really a discrete one.